widely as we can through various online communication channels. We also have paper copies available in just over 50 locations across the borough. So places like libraries, one-stop shops, children's centres, places like that have consultation information available and we'll hand it out to people. As well as this process, concurrently with this process was the statutory consultation in regards to staff. Obviously quite a few of these proposals have got some level of staff impact in terms of changes to roles, reductions in the number of roles, that kind of thing. So at the same time we've been running our consultation process with the trade unions at the same time. In terms of our response, we've got just over 10,000 responses. Proportion of the population remains relatively small. It's the highest, well, it's the highest response we've ever got to one of these exercises. Highest response that we can find of anywhere in the country for this kind of exercise. So you'll see from the chart there that's been running way back in 2010 when we've been running this kind of budget consultation exercise. Generally, steadily gets higher every year. Apart from that 1 year in 2011 when we didn't have really any specific budget proposals, but generally, it gets slightly higher every year. This is the highest one we've ever had. Unfortunately, this time, that translated in, we got an extra 2,000 or so responses this year that compared to last year. An awful lot of them seem to have come from Wirral West this year, so we've got Birkenhead and Wallasey particularly, which is slightly underrepresented in terms of numbers. That should be relatively even, that chart. Birkenhead's hopes should be slightly higher because it's more populous. But we generally Wirral West is always slightly overrepresented, but usually not quite to that extent. Which isn't ideal, not the end of the world, but it's not ideal. Everybody had a good opportunity to take part, it was widely promoted. That's just the way it's forward this year, unfortunately. What I'll do in a second is take you through the feedback we've had against each specific budget proposal. What I'll also mention when I'm going through the feedback from the public is where we've had specific representations from different organisations. Up to now, we've had three petitions. Now, those numbers are slightly more on those top two petitions now. But at the time of writing, we had an e-petition posted online regarding the Gertrude Court proposal, which at the time was putting together 280 signatures. That's now up to 110-ish, I think that's just more. The Unison petition, which is the second one, stop job cuts, that's about, I think, 21, 22 now. And the third one on the list there is a paper petition, which was delivered about 2 weeks ago. Around a specific school crossing patrol outside Christchurch School in London, that had 462 signatures. We may get more petitions in the run-up to major council on the 3rd of March, but that's what we've had so far.
Sorry,
which Christchurch
did you say?
Christchurch School in London. That's what it was. I didn't have a full address on it, but it just said Christchurch School in London. It was in regard to one specific school crossing patrol. Okay, so as part of the consultation this year, we had two kind of different types of questionnaires. We had one questionnaire that was told in general terms about ways of making savings, of generating more income, about operating more efficiently. Now what I'll do is I'll take you through the results of that particular survey, but I'll whiz through it because I know you're going to be more interested in seeing the feedback then for the specific proposals. So initially in that initial consultation, the more generic consultation questionnaire, we talked to people about shared services, which was generally about councils working together to provide trade services, joining the functions with people like Cheshire and organising councils and public sector bodies across the city region as a way to be more efficient and to save money. As you'll see from the charts, people have no problem with that whatsoever, really. There's not much in the way of opposition to that. We also asked people about charging for services. Similarly, we talked about commissioning and specifically whether the council needed to actually be the direct provider of certain services and whether it would be just as appropriate for us to really take what responsibility for the quality of the service, would people be comfortable with it actually commissioning that service to another organisation to deliver. And again, as you see, it's very similar to the one in terms of alternative delivery. Generally supported, but with some concerns, I think you probably do should know. Finally, on the more generic consultation, we talk about buildings and assets. As you're aware, the council owns and operates from hundreds of buildings across the world. This question specifically talked about whether we could do that better, operate from a smaller number of buildings, dispose of land and buildings, and just work together with partners across the public sector to just try and operate from a smaller number of physical locations. There doesn't seem to be much in the way of operations now at all. So that's the generic part of the consultation exercise, the questionnaire done. I'm now going to take you through the budget proposals themselves. The comments and the concerns and the various feedback from residents are all summarised here, so I'll try to summarise them in 1, 2, 3 bullet points against each proposal. That's also how it's been reported to Cabinet. Every comment that we've received through the consultation process from residents is all published online as well. So where the budget proposals originally were, so Wirral.co.uk/budget2016, every comment we've received was the budget proposals. Where appropriate as well, as I mentioned earlier on, where we've received feedback from an organisation or a specific group about the proposal, we've tried to reference that there and certainly reference them in the Cabinet report as well. So, first proposal to talk through is the garden waste charging proposal. This is a service that has been going for, I think, 3 years. It at the moment costs £35 a year or £30 a year if you pay it online. This proposal will be to increase that charge by £5 for the annual cost, so it goes to £35 online, £40 offline. Generally, I mean, if anyone wants to take the time to read through the comments. Sorry?
That's okay.
Oh, right. Generally, people were not concerned about this really good. We saw it as a relatively reasonable price increase in the main. As I say, I'm trying to summarise 202 comments, so it's generally people were fairly comfortable with that. The only the concerns that were raised were fairly light concerns about whether it could lead to increases in flight tip and reductions in recycling rates and things like that. But in the main, people generally were. The re-provision of the services provided by the Cllr report is clearly the most difficult and sensitive proposal this time. The first thing, probably most important thing to say about this is that there's a statutory consultation process going on at the same time. Now, what I mean is this is what I'm presenting to you today is the comments and the feedback that we've had from residents, the general public, if you like. At the same time, adult social service, social workers are actually sitting down with each individual family and person using the service and consulting with them on a one-to-one basis. That's, if you like, the real consultation in relation to this provides a commercial service to social landlords, general landlords, schools, private businesses. Can we do more of that? Can we make it more financially viable and sustainable and improve the service? With elements to that was you're looking at our dog fouling enforcement and looking to move that to the same model as we're going to be doing for lizard enforcement as well. So taking a much harder line in terms of dog fouling enforcement. Again, particularly in terms of dog fouling, people are actually generally really supportive of that. They've seen the kind of action and the kind of results that have taken place on litter, absolutely supportive in terms of dog fouling. The only real concern was that he wanted to make sure that there was no reduction in community safety services, which I don't think this will see anyway. So this one, again, relatively straightforward, I think, and relatively supported by the board, actually. Okay, so leisure centres was primarily to do with concessions and leisure centres. Just over 100 comments, and the concessions that we were talking about were primarily related to free school, which we offer at a cost of around about £500,000 to the council. So free swimming in school holidays for older people at certain times and for certain other groups. What the proposal was that we want to make the leisure centres financially sustainable longer term. We want to put them on a secure financial footing. At the moment they're being subsidised to the tune of £4 million every year. Trying to make it a little bit more commercial, we've removed those concessions. We also said that we'd look at Beechwood Leisure Centre, which is on the Beechwood Estate, obviously in Kingston, and there's an organisation, the Development Trust, I think, we're having conversations with potential community asset transfer. This proposal will also see us progress with that. Again, people were generally, in terms of that, the removal of the concessions, people generally seem fairly comfortable with that. The concerns we got were in relation to health and wellbeing and some around the antisocial behaviour, the stuff that we would expect, not a huge amount. People would generally fairly understand in this kind of economic climate, giving products away that you generally would expect to pay for is unusual, and I think people would generally understand that. We also have a proposal about the library service. Now, you'll all be aware of what the proposal was. It was out of our 24 libraries, 18 of them are classed as community sites, smaller sites. So we're looking at potentially transferring up to 12 of those into community ownership, community management, with the remainder, all of the remainder in council control and management. This wasn't planned to lead to any kind of, there was no plan to actually lead to specific closures on this, it was just about getting the country more volunteer. As I mentioned earlier on, we did get specific feedback from the Friends of the Library Steering Group about the viability of the proposal, about whether it was going to work effectively. But in terms of the general feedback, it was mainly in three main themes. If the library services relied more and more on volunteers, would it be less reliable? People were generally supportive if it resulted in no library closures. But some people were actually saying you've got 24 libraries, that's just far too many. Some people did say that. And quite a few residents actually expressed this concern about the impact on the service with the reduced number of librarians. And obviously their professional knowledge, their expertise. Similarly with parks, we had feedback from the Friends of Parks Forum, but it was very similar stuff in that we were looking at achieving the saving through encouraging and enabling more volunteers to get involved and take an active role in running of their parks, their local parks, which is already happening to an extent, to try to find a way to allow more of that to take place. Generally, similar feedback to the last one, in that people were comfortable with it, provided that there wasn't a massive loss in service, which again, I don't think this would be moving to. So generally, people were relatively supportive. Charging for pest control was a small element of our pest control service within environment health, and it was to do with, I think, the rapid pest or something like that. And we put a small charge in for actually doing that. The feedback was, generally some people were okay with it. The few people councils provided £700,000 a year from government to make major payments in this area to top people benefits where they're going to get the financial hardship. The council topped that up to a further £300,000. This proposal would see the council only spend on that particular area. People were relatively comfortable with that in terms of the feedback that we got. The other proposal would remove the council's in-house welfare rights advice service, which provides some fairly specialist support that takes people through what tier tribunals and appeals and complicated benefits related issues. Feedback on that was extremely supportive of the council service, generally, actually, about the actual about the way it goes and the value it's got. They are all the proposals that are out for consultation. The next steps is that the council is, as you all be aware, required to set the budget in March, including council tax levels. The feedback, the results of the consultation we forced to support the committee tomorrow, that's today obviously, that was last night's presentation. This feedback goes to Cabinet on the 22nd of August last week. Cabinet obviously will put the budget proposal forward then and we recommend the budget council in March. Okay.
Thank you very much, Kevin. I'm going to open to lots of questions. Just a little word of warning if you like. I don't intend to have a good debate. It would be appropriate. This is really to look at the process of the consultation.
Phil, did you want to ask a question? Then Janette.
Compared to previous processes, I don't know whether it's
has happened that in previous times, staff has spent a lot of time transcribing and typing out the answers that have come in, putting them in some form that members can refer to. Has that been done this time? Is there a link to a complete body that we could read through? The disparity. Laurie got, say, 1,200 people off the top of my head, this got 10,000. And when we got Maureen, we were told, oh, that's quite a good quantity, this is quite a good whack, it's fairly representative. So, in theory, 10,000 might be much better, depending on how you leave opinion polls. What I'm puzzled about is the no numbers taking part in the comments section. I don't know if there's anything off-putting about the layout or the technicalities of getting into the comments section, but it's surprising that even at best only 200 people out of 10,000 are sitting down and sending a detailed comment. And that was surprising. Is there any reason that's come across to officers for that low level?
Okay, through you, Chair, is the first point of the question was about the comparison between this and the body survey. It's apples and oranges, really. The body survey was market research, so it was sent out to a sample of the population that we got a 20% response from. This is a consultation, trying to get as many people to take part as possible. So it's two different things. This isn't market research, this is a consultation program. The second point about people actually filling in, there isn't really a general reason for it, but when we go back to the previous exercises, oftentimes there's only a small proportion of people who take the time to actually write detailed feedback. Oftentimes the vast majority of people just want to tick a couple of boxes and tell us roughly what they think. But it's usually always like that.
Thanks, Janette.
Yeah, apologies, can we get back? Because I said the same thing last night to you, I'm saying it, so I actually said, probably the response rate especially, do you think that, as Ross just said, is it policy are the least satisfied with the council and the least participation rate from policy, which is sad because, you know, Wirral West, there's reasons we can all speculate as to why West is Wirral West, the more likely to think not to cast it, the more likely not to be there, and therefore more likely to represent their interests, and would like to think that first. Still got a mechanism to represent Wallasey, despite not having a very good take on that. And just a question, really, about the comments. You said overwhelming, you know, or generally. Did you just sort of go through all the comments and do a little bit of percentage-wise, and then come to the conclusion that that was
Through you, Joe, what I'd say is that if you take a bit of time just and scan through them, you'll start immediately getting a feel of what people are saying. Right. People will generally make similar points as they go through it. What I've also picked up as well is in terms of the low response rate for the policy, almost 2,000 people policy took part in this consultation. Generally, a put on our side, won't get 2,000 people at all take part in the consultation exercise or anything. 2,000 people, you look at Liverpool, Liverpool get 500, 600 people taking part in their budget consultation exercise. We just got big numbers here. 2,000 people from whatever would be a big number, generally.
Proportionally,
it's small. Looking regionally, nationally, as well.
Christina.
Sorry, I don't know whether I've not heard one thing. What was the better response, the paper copy that you gave out, or of the internet? And would that, can you break that down into constituencies for us?
Yes, I can do both. I can break down in terms of what was paper and what was online, overwhelmingly online. You got both paper. Even the paper copy says you can complete this online, you will pick it up and go on the go on and do it online.
David, I think that's everybody then. Yeah, David?
Interesting box pops. I must confess I'd be a little disappointed if tomorrow, when you're obviously talking amongst yourselves, that you try and analyse it by the nature of where we're actually looking at. The fact that Wallasey didn't respond is Wallasey's problem. You tend to find that if people are unhappy, they will respond in greater numbers. Not everybody at Wirral West actually owns a Porsche. So please, Janette, it's beneath you to start assuming that everybody in Wirral West is just a vested interest who really
I didn't interpret it that way, Jim. Yeah. Well, no, 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 no note the content of the report. Right, the next item on the agenda is item 5, and it is the report of the workshops and the budget. Joe, do you want to say something? Okay, just briefly as a bit of an overview, we use the same approach, workshop approach, this year as was used last year, with each committee holding its own workshop to give opportunity for its members to examine in more detail the proposals put forward by the officers. The obvious intention was to better understand the service implications and the achievability of the proposals as they were presented. I do think that members who took part found them helpful, and the purpose tonight is really to note the process that we've used and perhaps comment on that and whether that could be improved upon in the future, and also note the outcome of the workshops, and then forward these documents to the Cabinet. I know they've already been pre-produced and they are full part of the Cabinet papers for next week. I think all members of it and the Council understand the scale of the task that's underway at the moment over the budget. And I do hope that, we will be, as I said earlier on the early report, we'll be debating these proposals tonight. That wouldn't be appropriate. But I do hope that the non-elected, non-executive members of the Council, this can form a good part of the consultation, their views on the consultation. And that's what it intended to be. I'll give a brief overview of what happened at Families and Wellbeing, and then I'll ask the other chairs of the two committees to do the same. The session that was on held by Families and Wellbeing was, of course, because he was very well attended. No, unfortunately, Wendy was on that. But other than that, we had a full turnout. And there was, I think everybody contributed in some form during the discussions that we had. Obviously, some of the proposals that were put forward generated more discussion and comment than others. What the committee didn't attempt to do was to recommend or reject any of the proposals. We didn't see that as our role. What we did do was to use the workshops to dig deeper than the narrative that was presented by around the proposal by officers, and to examine in more detail the impact, whether that be a positive impact or a negative impact. And if we thought were negative impacts, to highlight those and possibly make suggestions as to how the negative impact could be mitigated. And also we looked at the achievability of the savings, because in the past savings haven't always been achieved, and that tends to help us in the following year. Following the workshop, further information was requested on how modelling the saving around the concessions on leisure. want to change the narrative of the families who are in workshop support. Now, obviously, if other people feel differently, I'll have to put that to a vote. But that's as chair of the families and wellbeing and person who signed off the report, that's my view. The points were raised, they were explored, they have been commented on, and other consultations that maybe have taken place since can report in their own way, and I'm sure they will. But this is the work of the members of the families and wellbeing who sit at that workshop that night, and therefore they need to change it. Okay. But I'll take questions on this one.
So just a comment. If it's legitimate to receive information later on, as you mentioned, over the swimming cost issue, and members are able to get a bit more information on certain issues, they're reflected in what's submitted. And it seems equally legitimate, no offence from Rob. But here what's been said, the concerns that have been raised in other places since, and then to reflect on what the working party heard, and to try and satisfy ourselves as the
I understand the point you're making, but I don't agree with it. The points that were raised, one of them was raised on the night by a member of the committee, and the other was raised by a member of the committee at a later stage. So I think that in a different situation to try and use this committee to change or highlight an area where that was one of those were a range of concerns that were raised on the night on this issue. But other positive things were put forward as well. So just to highlight those, I think would almost change the emphasis. And I understand that you will feel strongly, and I'm sure that you will make a representation. And the other consultations that are underway will also put their feedback in. That's for them to do, and for those people who are the subject of that consultation to do, not for the members of the committee. And that's, I've got any more to say on this. If you want to put it as a proposal, I'm quite happy to put it to a vote.
I think, Chair, first of all, I'm conscious there are a couple of deputies. I'm conscious that one of the members will have been working during the day. Yes. Might not have seen what I circulated. What I did circulate was the summary, I thought, plus some suggestions, and I'm conscious that not everyone will have seen it. But we often suggest things during a meeting that people haven't seen. And I'm not sure, perhaps, if there are members who have seen what I wrote, even if it was about 10 to midnight last night, if there are members who agree that it's reasonable to put it forward, they might say so. And we might be able to judge the feeling of members. Because, of course, I'm sitting here happily on my own, in my own little group, like that, my own little world.
As I say, Phil, if you want to read out your email, and then if you want to move it and get a seconder, then we'll put it to a vote. So if that's what you want to do, fine.
I'm getting some indications from members, some members nodding who have read it, that agree with the points that I raised, and I'm conscious it's very lengthy. For the courtesy of other members, would you agree it should read it out and then the members can consider
yes.
it?
Yes.
Go
on briefly, because I
want
to
be able to do it.
I'd like to take the advice of the chair. I don't think we can have any email.
We want to be fair, don't we? So I want to give Phil, I'm sure it's very difficult for him managing on his own. And I want to give him a benefit of in this. So you read it out, Phil, and then if you want to move it as well.
Thank you for your courtesy, Chair.
Yes,
thank you. I was courteous. I'm going to read carefully, modestly. This meeting of the Policy and Performance Coordinating Committee wishes to highlight the concerns expressed by members of the Budget Scheme Working Party relating to services offered at Girton Court. During those deliberations, it was recognised that, quote, the key challenge is to meet the needs of individuals for what can be provided, and that, quote, assurances were sought about availability and quality of the independent sector provision, and also how each person would have their needs assessed, unquote. It was also reported that all respite will be honoured until March 2016, but provision will be continued until all reviews are complete and all users have alternative provision in place. That's the quote. Then we're on to write. A view of the concerns raised since the working party met, it is even more important that attention is given to meeting the detailed needs of the families involved. Services need to be offered at Girton Court until it is clear that a range of providers are in place and lined up to offer services truly tailored to the physical, recreational and emotional needs of the users and are demonstrably appropriate to their ages and circumstances. A view of the tight timescales that have caused concern, the officers and cabinet need to ensure that the transition to future provision is appropriately managed, with clients able to use services at the airport court until such time as alternatives are duly commissioned.
Thank you very much.
That's a fair reading.
Thank you very much. And that was well said. Yes, so I do want to move to a vote on this.
I just want to voice some concern that this is being attached to a report that came from the Families and Wellbeing Committee. It just strikes me that this is something that should stand on its own, as opposed to if it's going to go forward at all. I was on that committee and I'd like it to remain, the report to remain as it was.
I'm going to put it to a vote, Phil, so I don't want everybody in around the room giving their opinion. I don't think it's needed. Wendy, I'll just take one more comment, and then I haven't if Phil wants me to put it to the vote. I draw people's attention to page 15 to the report. Chair, this is a report which is coming from this committee, and so it's got our name on it. This particular bunch of people is happening tonight, and I would like to say that I will second that. Okay, well, we'll put it to a vote and we'll move on. All those in favour of Phil's suggestion that we attach that on email, Wendy's just seconded it. All those in favour of that be attached to the report of Families and Wellbeing, please show. And those against. So that was not carried, and the report. Because the report has been sent to these members and there's been an action arising on it.